Yesterday, I was on Glenn Beck's radio show to talk about the psychology behind why people are going absolutely psychotic when they see people who do not wear masks. And I wanted to just elaborate on a couple of the points that I made on the show because we didn't have a whole lot of time and I have many more thoughts on the topic. Now, at the beginning of this video, I want to be very clear, YouTube overlords, I am not giving medical advice. I'm not commenting on the effectiveness of masks. I'm not doing these things. If you want to know, go talk to your doctor. I am not that type of doctor. I'm a psychologist. What I can comment on is why people are losing their minds when they see someone who is not wearing a mask. And I can give you a couple recent examples of this. So this is something that happened yesterday. This is a woman who lost her mind on two little girls in a store because they weren't wearing masks and walked away saying, "I hope you all die." Two children who were not wearing masks. The children, by the way, were not required to wear masks because of their age, which the mother tried to explain to the older lady before she wished death upon children. The next incident that happened recently is a man was actually pepper sprayed. He was pepper sprayed by a stranger in a park for not wearing a mask. Like, this is actual insanity. Let's just read a little bit of this story. A woman has posted a video of a stranger attacking her husband with pepper spray for allegedly not wearing a coronavirus mask at San Diego Dog Park while having lunch. "This had me crying hysterically in the background because my innocent husband just got maced for no reason." Now, I'm not sure I would say I would cry hysterically if my husband got maced for no good reason. But you know, to each their own. I'm pretty sure though that I would not be crazy enough to pepper spray a stranger because I'm upset that they weren't wearing a mask. And then I saw this story on Yahoo probably about a week ago. It's okay to yell at strangers who don't wear masks. And it says roughly 2/3 of Americans say they wear masks in public. Unfortunately, that still leaves a substantial portion of potential COVID-19 carriers unmasked, coming across anyone flouting public health recommendations and putting you, your family, and your community at risk triggers a number of thoughts and feelings. Depending on the situation, your annoyance could range from mild simmer to all-out rolling boil. So what do you do? Now, we're not going to read this whole article about why it's okay to yell at strangers in public for not wearing a mask, but I just want to show you, they actually have gone so far as to create 5 stages of mask-wearing grief to give you some frame of reference about when it's okay to accost strangers in public for not wearing a mask, ranging from mild annoyance all the way up to go F yourself. Under the go F yourself stage, here the person seems willfully to be endangering those around them. Your anger is appropriately ballistic. Now, how they define willfully endangering people is literally, I mean, they say it right here, standing in line with kids and elderly people. That's how they define willfully endangering people to the point where you're allowed to accost them in public. This is insane. This is actual insanity. Because listen, man, like the whole purpose behind masks originally, back in the day, let's rewind a couple months back. When the first thing they told us was socially distance. Now, socially distancing is pretty easy. Just don't walk around people. Admittedly, I live in New Hampshire. It's probably much easier for me to socially distance on a day-to-day basis, but I was socially distancing like a mother effer. I was keeping my distance from anyone. I was carrying around hand sanitizer wherever I went, using it very, very liberally, but I've always been opposed to wearing masks for a variety of reasons. For me, my opposition to wearing masks, unless I absolutely have to, comes from, it's more the psychology of it. I think that when you're covering up the thing you literally use to express yourself, I don't think that's psychologically good. I think it's going to make for a more docile society. It's going to make for people to be less inclined to express themselves unapologetically, to share their ideas, all that sort of thing. I also think it says something about, because, you know, on a psychological level, our willingness to voice our beliefs is an indication about how much we value ourselves and we unapologetically love ourselves if we're willing to communicate our ideas out to the world. And I think that it's a dangerous thing to actively inhibit people from doing that communication just purely on a psychological level. I also think that masks are incredibly dehumanizing. One of the reasons that we're seeing issues like this is because we have literally stopped looking at each other as human beings. When you're seeing people randomly pepper spray strangers, when you're seeing older women wish death upon children for not wearing masks, when you're seeing things like, oh gosh, Ted Cruz got photographed on a plane for not wearing a mask, and if you look at the response to his tweets, a lot of people are wishing that he gets sick. We have literally started to dehumanize each other over this issue. And from my perspective, the psychology of this is actually pretty basic. It's basic fight or flight response. Because the media has spun the public up. I purely blame the media on this one. They have spun the public up to the point where people legitimately believe that if you are around someone that is not wearing a mask, that is a life and death issue. And it's not. It is not a life or death issue. First off, you don't even know if that person has it. Obviously, like a lot of us, well, I mean, I haven't gotten it, but a lot of people who get it are asymptomatic. They don't even know that they have it. We don't know who has it and who doesn't. And there's also the assumption that if someone's not wearing a mask, that means 100% they're going to transmit it to everyone around them, which is simply not true. It is absolutely not true, especially if you're outside. Like, this poor guy that gets pepper sprayed at a dog park, it is almost impossible to transmit this virus when you're outside. Again, I'm not a medical professional. I'm not giving medical advice. Go talk to your doctors. But everything that I've seen indicates that it is very, 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 very difficult to transmit this outside. That's why things are opening outside first. That's why outside dining is open. That's why beaches are open. That's why you can go for hikes in the park, all this stuff, because it is very difficult to transmit the virus when you're outside, regardless of if you're wearing a flipping mask or not. But I want to talk about fight or flight, because this is actually a real thing. And because the media has spun people up so much to the point where they actually believe, and I believe this is a real belief, anytime we're seeing someone go off the handle, like all of the cases that I've just pointed out to you, that is a real belief. This is not a feigned belief. This is not something that we're doing because it's politically convenient to demonize our enemies or any of those things. I actually believe that anytime you're seeing someone go off the handle, it is because their fight or flight response has been activated. So let's learn a little bit about what fight or flight response is and what actually happens in your body when that's activated and what that means for this issue around people going insane when they see someone not wearing a mask. So this is from the Cleveland Clinic. What happens to your body during fight or flight response? Your survival responses explained. Someone cut you off on the highway and you had to swerve and narrowly avoided a collision. While out for a morning run, an angry dog jumps out onto your path and starts growling and barking at you. In the second before you turned on your light in your empty house, your coat rack looked like it was a person standing right next to you. All three of these scenarios can trigger your body's natural fight or flight response, which is driven by your sympathetic nervous system. This response is your body's reaction to danger and was designed to help you survive stressful or life-threatening situations. So let's pause right there. The way the brain evolved, the number one thing that it cares about is our survival. Now, this makes sense. In the scenarios that this article outlines, you might be scared of a stranger in your house, you might be scared you're going to get bit by a dog, you might be scared you're going to get hit by a car. All those things are directly related to your survival, your ability to continue life on this planet. So when we encounter things that we believe are dangerous to us, dangerous to our survival, that activates our sympathetic nervous system, which lights up like a Christmas tree and prepares us to do one of two things. It prepares us to go into battle and fight aggressively, or it prepares us to turn around and haul ass in the other direction. If you think about these stories you hear about, you know, people suddenly getting like endorphin rushes and being able to do amazing physical feats of strength, that's part of what's going on here is all of your resources, all of your mental energy, all of your physical energy, if your body identifies that something is putting you in danger, physical danger, what have you, it's going to immediately redirect all of the resources it has to fending off that danger, whether that's through fighting aggressively or running in the other direction. Now, someone not wearing a mask around you is not inherently dangerous. You can do a lot of things when people are not wearing a mask around you. You can choose to walk around them at a very, very wide berth so you don't have to come anywhere near them. You can choose to maybe talk to the manager of the store to have them go talk to the person. There are many options besides pepper spraying them and wishing them death. But people are not choosing those logical, rational options because the minute that they identify that someone's, oh my god, someone's not wearing a mask, they literally feel as though their physical safety, their ability to continue life on this planet has been put into jeopardy. And that's why they go insane. Let's keep going. The fight or flight response or stress response is triggered by a release of hormones, either prompting us to stay and fight or run away and flee, explains psychologist Carolyn Fisher, PhD. During the response, all bodily systems are working to keep us alive in what we've perceived as a dangerous situation. Without you even telling it what to do, your body is assessing what's going on around you and determining your options on how you're most likely to survive the event. And when this happens, you're in flow. You're not thinking about it. I mean, you can probably think back to moments in your life where you've had this kind of like rush come through your body and you go into total focus on how to fight or flee the situation. Everything is directed towards that. And you're almost going on autopilot. You as a human being at that point are not really thinking. Your brain has taken over and it's like, I'm gonna do whatever I can do to get you out of this situation alive. That's what's happening. So you can probably think of those moments. Probably the most common one is the dog running out in front of the car is probably the easiest example. You're kind of like driving down the road and during the day and everything's going great and all of a sudden you see an animal run in front of your car and your whole body jumps to alert and you slam on the brake really, really quickly without even thinking about it and you feel this rush of energy. Almost like, and the minute that the event is over and the dog is okay and you're okay, you like, oh my god, and you feel so tired. Almost instantly. Maybe it didn't even last that long, but because all your resources were directed at that one event, it's like almost, it physically exhausts you as soon as it's over. Let's keep reading. Here's what can happen during the stress response. Your heart rate and blood pressure increases. That means you're probably breathing more quickly and heavily, which is helping you move nutrients and oxygens out to your major muscle groups. You're pale or have flushed skin. Your blood flow is being redirected, so you might experience feeling cold or like your hands and feet are cold and clammy. Your face might also appear flush as hormones circulate throughout your body. Blunt pain response is compromised. If your sympathetic nervous system is triggered by combat or collision, it's not uncommon to only feel your injuries once you've returned to safety and have time to calm down. Dilated pupils, your pupils will dilate to take in more light so you can see better. You're on edge. I mean, it's what we're seeing in all of these instances, right? You're more aware and observant in your responses. You're looking and listening for things that could be dangerous. Your senses are heightened and you're keenly aware of what's going on around you. Your memories can be affected. Sometimes during stressful experiences, your memories of the world can be altered. Your memories can be very clear or vivid, or they can be blacked out. You're tense or trembling. Stress hormones are circulating throughout your body, so you might feel tense or twitchy, like your muscles are about to move at any given moment, and your bladder might be affected, I don't think I need to expound on that. During the fight or flight response, your body is trying to prioritize, so anything it doesn't need for immediate survival is placed on the back burner. That might mean digestion, reproductive, and growth hormone production and tissue repair are all temporarily halted. Instead, your body is using all of its energy on the most critical priorities and functions. The stress response can be triggered in a single instant, but how quickly you calm down and return to your natural state is going to vary from person to person, and it will depend on what caused it. Typically, it takes 20 to 30 minutes for your body to return to normal and to calm down. Now, what this article is not really emphasizing enough, I don't believe, is that this is all about perception. This is about individual perception. In fact, I see fight or flight responses triggered in the work environments all the time. Well, and people are not in physical danger, most of them, like when they're in their work environment, especially people who are just like average office workers, kind of white collar office workers, things like that. They're not going to be put in any physical danger. But what triggers your fight or flight response at work is if you get in, put in a situation where you think you're going to get fired. That's what triggers it, because a lot of people, especially if they've never been fired before, they've never been through a job loss, they internalize their job so much as part of their identity that if they lose that job, that is like a death. That's what it's like. And if they think that they're in any danger of losing their job at all, whether it is real or it is not real, that can trigger your fight or flight response in the work environment. The mask issue is exactly the same thing. It's the same thing. Most people, though, based on how the media has completely spun up this situation, are going to see someone like me not wearing a mask and go, "You are putting me and my family in physical danger, and I'm going to fight you aggressively with every fiber of my being." That's what's happening. It is about perception. It is not about reality. It's not about data. It's not about do masks work or don't they? And again, YouTube overlords, I'm not making a comment on whether or not they work. It is about, do people perceive that I have put them in physical danger? And if someone perceives that I've put them in physical danger, they could very well attack me, just like the people in the instances that I've already shown got attacked. I also think, too, that, and this is kind of like a little side note, I think there has to be some overlap. We've had such a weird confluence of events in the last, you know, several months or so, where not only do we have, you know, a mask means I'm going to survive versus a mask, like not wearing a mask means I'm not going to survive. We also have, you know, there's some weird overlap with the white fragility stuff, isn't there? The white fragility stuff, all of the Black Lives Matter stuff that's going on right now is basically saying you are a good person if you adhere to this ideology. You are a bad person if you adhere to this ideology. And I think that actually does overlap with the mask, because everything is political nowadays. So what's going on is people are perceiving you are a good person if you just capitulate and wear your mask in public, and that means you care about other people, because really, Carlin, a mask is not about protecting yourself, because we know masks are actually not effective at that. And again, I'm not a doctor, but you're a good person if you wear a mask because you are protecting other people, and you are a bad person if you do not wear a mask. It's this black and white thinking that has taken over our culture, and all nuance has become lost in this discussion. And when all nuance is lost, you have things like men getting pepper sprayed in a park because someone disagrees with them, or small children having death wished upon them because we aren't able to have conversations about nuance anymore. Now, do I think this is like a direct correlation between this and white fragility? No, I think that both of these things and many of the other challenges that we're seeing in terms of bridging the divide in this country right now has to do with people's lack of ability to interact with nuanced situations, nuanced discussions. I mean, think about it. When was the last time that you truly had a nuanced discussion? For me, it was yesterday, but That was an exception. I don't usually actually have discussions as nuanced as the one I had yesterday on this channel. It's actually a great discussion. Check it out if you want to. It was about the historical inaccuracies of the 1619 Project. Really, really fantastic discussion. But day to day, I don't have those discussions. I wish I did. I wish we had more of them. We've gotten out of the habit. And in getting out of that habit of considering nuance, this is where we find ourselves. In these situations where everything is black and white, right or wrong, you are a good person or an evil person that is threatening my survival and I have to attack you outright. So that's essentially what I think is going on with people being crazy about the mask issue. It's their bodies going into fight or flight because the media has spun them up to a point where they very literally think that their survival is threatened if they see someone not wearing a mask. Now, I'm sure there's other nuanced things going on as well. If you have thoughts about that, leave a comment. I'd like to hear what you have to say as well. But I think, you know, maybe one of the most important things to understand about this issue is you can disrupt your thought process if you find yourself getting into this. Yes, spoiler alert, there are actually other options that don't involve pepper spraying strangers. And so if you find yourself in these situations, it's okay to kind of take a beat, take a few deep breaths, calm your body down. Deep breathing is great. Don't wear a mask when you're trying to do deep breathing. Just go off into a corner somewhere, like be by yourself, because you cannot do deep breathing when you're wearing a mask. It's not possible. But just make sure you're taking in a few deep breaths. It'll calm down your nervous system and you're able to look at the situation much more clearly. And of course, these are things I can't teach people because I'll be told I'm a bad person for telling them not to wear a mask. All right, that's all I've got for this one. I'll see you guys soon.